next week. So on the 31st, so y'all come back on the 31st. You'll also see on the inside, you'll see some other announcements that are going on. Like we have a garage sale coming up. We also have a church cleanup day that's happening on the day before Easter, which is April 21st is Easter. So we want you to be here on that day. You'll also see some congratulations and condolences that are in order. And you need to remember that we as a church, even though you may not know some of these people, when one celebrates, we all celebrate. And when one mourns, we all mourn. So please keep this in mind. We want to remember Cherry Redwine and her family. Her husband James died this last week, and his services are actually tomorrow here at the church at 11. And I know Cherry and her family are here this morning, so we want to remember them. But we also have some folks that did not make it into the worship guide because life happens, okay? Life doesn't always hit deadlines, so we want you to be aware of this. Kitty Stalkup, her children's father, they'd been married for 25 years. The children's father died. His name was Robert Steele. She attends our 8:15 service, so we want to remember her. Wayne Bogan found out this morning. He is an usher at the 8:15 service. Found out his mother in Cincinnati died this morning, so we want to remember him. And so if you know Wayne, come alongside him. Also, Jim and Barbara Biggers, they're members of this church, and they have a brother-in-law who passed away. And then many of you know Anna Rose. She's the principal of Acton Elementary School. Her dad, Randy Stepp, after a long battle with cancer, died this last week. And actually, his services are in Cleburne this afternoon. So if you've gone through Acton Elementary School or you know of Anna Rowe, don't just lift up happy thoughts. Reach out to her. Let her know that she is loved and you are coming alongside her and her family. Congratulations are in order. We want to celebrate with Alice and Ronnie Cox on their 52nd wedding anniversary. So we can give God thanks for them. Gary and Yvonne Simerson on their 45th wedding anniversary. We want to give God thanks for them. Ed and Nancy Selheimer on their 25th wedding anniversary. And to Clint and Carol Jones for celebrating their first wedding anniversary. So we want to give God thanks to them. Thank you all for being flexible this morning. We also want to welcome those who are worshiping with us online. I think we've got them online. Is that correct? Yeah, so y'all turn around and say hey to the people who are online. Hey, one of the things I love about this in all seriousness is that for the longest time, seriously, people didn't worship in churches. They worshiped without electricity, and still God was glorified. So I kind of actually love this. This is pretty cool. So maybe the electricity will go out again. Right. I'm not preaching today, so it's going to be okay. Amy's preaching on that. So we're glad everybody is here. Won't you stand up, find someone that you haven't said hi to, and greet them with the love of Christ.
You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy of this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yes, thank you, God.
You are perfect in all of
His love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, you're a good, good Father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am, you're a good, good Father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am, you're a good, good Father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am, you're a good, good Father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am.
Father God, we give you praise this morning. We thank you. And no matter what happens, you are here. We worship you in spirit and truth. Help us to just put away all distractions in our heart, all the distractions in our mind, that we may truly worship you. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that walks with us, talks with us every day. We ask that you just build our lives in a way that is pleasing and honoring to you. Father, we just thank you so much. Worthy of every breath.
above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. Oh, we live for you. Put my trust in you.
Let's pray. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks that you are in this place today. God, we give you thanks that even though we might have difficulties, God, that you have no difficulty in reaching us. God, we thank you that before we even knew that we could reach out to you, God, that you were reaching out to us, God, that you sent your Son to live, to die, to be raised again, that we might get to know you more and we might get to live changed lives. God, as you have poured out your Holy Spirit, continue to pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here. God, as Pastor Amy comes to bring the message, we pray that you'd pour out your Spirit upon her. That God, as your Spirit has testified to her, God, that we would be open to hearing what you have to say today. We pray these things in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's give it up for Wayne and the band. I always appreciate whenever you lead us. It's good to have you back. We're actually birthday twins, right? April 27th? Yep, April 27th. So you can think of both of us on April 27th. It's good to be back together today, and I had to kind of laugh whenever, I mean, I didn't laugh because I felt bad, but I also kind of had to laugh whenever I realized that today was going to be a little different and that the breakers had gone out, because this particular message that I've been working on for quite some time seems like it's had about 9 lives. I've changed it, and I've changed it, and I've changed it, and today I even changed it again, and it may change now. That's the power of the Holy Spirit, because we're talking about change. Wade, you're never allowed to pick this again. No, I'm just kidding. Change is good for us. I really think it is. So here we find ourselves pausing wherever we are to hear from the Lord on this day, and I changed the scripture, because, you know, why not? But before we do that, I know some of us are in the season of Lent, and some of us don't even realize we're in the season of Lent. Did you know we're in the season of Lent? Did anyone not know? Okay, well, I'm going to tell you that the season of Lent is the 40 days leading to Easter. It's a time when we prepare our hearts and our minds for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we do that so that we can understand the fullness of the story by the time we get there. And I'll tell you, it was kind of fun in Bible study this week at the morning session. We were all going around and doing our Lent check-ins, and someone in the class asked a very good question. They said, "We're really confused. We know it's 40 days of Lent, but every time we get at our calendar and we count from Ash Wednesday to Easter, it's 47. Did we start Ash Wednesday on the wrong day?" And that's actually a very legit question, and I said, don't worry, you're not crazy. Many people have wondered that. The season of Lent, there are 40 days of self-denial, of fasting from something, of taking on a practice, and those 40 days remind us of when Jesus was in the wilderness. But there are still seven Sundays of Lent, which are considered mini Easters. And we observe those to remember that we hope and we know what is coming. So today is a Sunday. You can have your donut. You can check Facebook if you need to. But tomorrow is right back to business. So I just wanted to thank the person who asked the question, because I think a lot of us probably maybe wonder that ourselves. So 40 days in Lent, 47 days till Easter total. Sundays are mini Easters. And I did, again, as I told you, I changed the scripture. So you have Romans in your worship guide, but I'm about to share with you John chapter 1, verses 35 through 46. The next day, John was standing again with two of his disciples. Then he saw Jesus walking along and said, "Look, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard what he said, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he asked, "What are you looking for?" They said, "Rabbi," which is translated teacher, "where are you staying?" He replied, "Come and see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4:00 in the afternoon. One of the two disciples who heard what Jesus said and followed Jesus was Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter. He first found his own brother, Simon, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated Christ. He led them to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which translates to Peter. Then the next day, Jesus wanted to go into Galilee, and he found Philip. Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Philip was from Bethsaida, the hometown of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and the prophets, Jesus, Joseph's son from Nazareth." Nathanael responded, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" Philip said, "Come and see." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So let us pray. Oh God, you are ever changing even in this moment. You have shown us that today, and we are thankful because change gives us an opportunity to grow and to be more open to your spirit and to step out of our comfort zones. So now as we pause just for a few moments to hear a little bit from you, we pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to take over this room, that it would open the hearts and minds of all who are here. I pray that I would step out of the way and that it would be your voice, not mine. In your name we pray. Amen. Probably you're going, "Oh no, change. Wade talked about it 2 weeks ago, and then he talked about it last Sunday. We're talking about it again. Why do we have to do this?" Well, change is not bad. If things don't change, then God can't do anything new, right? So some of you, one sermon on change was plenty, but I encourage you to step aside of your anxiety and just allow God to be with you in the discomfort and the possibility of change. And as we do that, we need to have a couple different questions to wrestle with. So I want you to think right now, with all the changes that you have gone through in your life since March 1st, a year ago, how has your relationship with God changed? Hopefully it has. Hopefully you see some type of growth, maybe forward, maybe back, but you're progressing. You're not just staying the same, right? And do you see those changes as positive or negative? Now, I'm 35. I'll be 36 on when? Anybody remember? April 27th. Thank you. And I have not learned a whole lot in my life, but I have learned that there are two things that we all do that are a part of our lives. We are all born, and we all die. I'm really motivational today, right? We are all born, and we all die. Okay? In between, a lot of changes happen, and a lot of things take place, and, you know, each of us will probably be different. However, even in those two things that are the great equalizer that we all do, birth and death, there's change. Does anybody think that your life changes when you have a baby? Can I get an amen? This new parents right over here are raising their hand. When you die, that changes too. You, the person who dies, goes on to be with God. And the people who are left behind, they have to face change. They have to face holes where people were before. Things are left undone. So that's why we have to talk about change, because change happens, whether you like it or not. Even in the two things we will all do, there is change. What is the one constant in our life? What is the one thing that doesn't change? Is there anything? Yes. The good news is that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ will never change. Ever. So we change, the world changes around us, but Jesus Christ remains the same. So I find myself wondering, if that's really our one constant, why don't we invest more into our relationship with Jesus Christ? Why don't we think more about it or pay attention to it? So I want you to take a moment and ask yourself, what is your relationship with Jesus like today? Maybe you don't have one. Maybe you do, but you stopped talking to God a long time ago because you got mad. Maybe you feel like you're just a lost cause and you knew Jesus at one point, but there's no hope for you today. Maybe you do have a relationship with the Lord. I know many of you are faithful prayer warriors and you're always talking to God. Maybe your relationship is so strong that at every moment of the day, you're talking to Jesus and asking for help. Or maybe you're somewhere in the middle. You know Jesus, but you don't put a lot of thought into the relationship. Wherever you are, the good news is that Jesus Christ will meet us right where we are today. Now, I got an opportunity to go to a Stephen Curtis Chapman concert about a month or so ago. Pastor Margaret, who used to serve here, decided to be a wonderfully generous friend and decided to give me tickets to that for my birthday early. And I went because I love Stephen Curtis Chapman. He kind of has a soundtrack of my life. And I went kind of thinking, you know, it's going to be his same normal things, because it was a remembrance tour. He was remembering and looking back on what God had done in his life. And then he told a story, and I had not heard it before, and I thought, you know, that is important. Other people need to hear that. So Stephen Curtis Chapman accepted Christ when he was 8 years old. He was sitting in a pew kind of like you in a church, and the pastor said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." And at that moment, right then and there, at 8 years old, he said he felt like Jesus was knocking on the door of his heart, and he simply had to respond. So he did. The only problem was, the pastor was a King James Version kind of guy. And so, the next part said, "If any man shall hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and sup with him, and he with me." And Stephen Curtis Chapman was 8 years old, so he didn't understand that Jesus was saying, "I will come eat with you." He thought Jesus was coming in and saying, "Sup? What's up?" True story. As he got older, though, he started to realize that maybe his interpretation wasn't completely wrong. At that moment, Jesus Christ really was coming into his life and saying, "Sup? I want to be in a relationship with you. What's going on in your life?" And in that moment, his relationship with God changed. That's important for us to realize that that wasn't the first time that Jesus had been in Stephen Curtis Chapman's life. He had been there all along. When we are born, before we are born, the grace of God is at work in our lives. And it continues to be until we recognize our need for a relationship with God through Jesus. And so God had already been in Stephen Curtis Chapman's life, but in that moment, Jesus Christ was coming in and saying, "Sup, Stephen? I want to be in a relationship with you." And he was aware for the first time ever. That's the same for us. God has always been in our lives. We just have to realize it. We just have to take a moment and let it in. Now, some of you had that happen instantly, in like a moment that you can recall, and maybe some of you had it kind of unfold over time like me. Neither way is right or wrong. What's important is that somehow you got there and you were called forth to change. There's that word again. You began to change and you entered into a relationship with Jesus, and hopefully your ideas and your way of thinking and living changed, right? So when did your relationship for you with Jesus change? Or does it need to change today? As I thought about it and as I reflected on that, I started remembering, and this is where the change happened of the scripture, I started thinking about Jesus calling the disciples, and I started to think that there was something really important for us to see in there, because, you know, you see John the Baptist, he's the one who prepared the way for Jesus. And he had these two followers, these two disciples who had come to know him through his teaching and had been walking and following and learning from him. And then John knows that he's a human. He has only a limited capacity of what he can give them. But there is someone greater who they truly need. And so he sees Jesus and immediately he identifies Jesus and he says, "See, the Lamb of God." Immediately a change begins to happen, and those men turn and follow Jesus. They step away from John and they recognize that Jesus is the true teacher, the true source. And I like that they don't speak, because I kind of think they're like us, where they're like, okay, I understand that this is a really big deal and the change is happening in me because I've met Jesus, but I don't really know what to say or how to approach him or what to do, so I'm just going to follow quietly. And what I love is that Jesus makes the first move. Jesus turns to them and he says, what are you looking for? What are you looking for? What are you looking for in your life right now? Are you looking for power or money or reassurance? What are you looking for? You can keep looking and keep looking, but ultimately when it comes right down to it, only one thing will give you true security, and that is the love of a relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus turns to them and he says, what are you looking for? And they say, we want to come to your house. Where are you staying? And I think that it might be confusing, like, why would they say that? But if you think about it, do you really want to tell a person your deep, dark secrets on a street? Probably not. You want to go somewhere more private. And I feel like these disciples had troubles and things on their hearts and their minds that they wanted to tell Jesus. And so they didn't want to stand in the middle of the street and talk. They wanted to go into his home where he was staying and share their troubles. And Jesus responds and he says, come and see. So he's inviting them in. He's inviting them in. And in that moment, they let their relationship go deeper. Because only Jesus can give us true peace. And they learned that and they started to follow him. Now, did everything just go easy from that point on? No, that doesn't happen that way. When you get married and you say, I do, afterwards, do you live forever in wedded honeymoon bliss? No. Things happen in life, and we get to spend the rest of our life trying to figure out how to live into the vows that we took, for better or for worse, through the ups and downs. That's how it is with God. When we enter into that relationship, it's not always easy. Change happens, things get hard. But God is still the same. And so instead of letting that separate us from God, we need to lean in to God. Because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And when we do that, it makes a huge difference. Today at 11 o'clock, we are commissioning a new group of Stephen ministers. These are people who have gone through 50 hours of training in order to be qualified to sit with people in need, to listen, to remind them of the presence of Christ. And one of the people we're commissioning today is Mindy Badgett. Some of you may know her. She kind of attends different services, whatever the mood strikes her or her schedule allows. So you've seen her in here before. She's just like you. And she is being commissioned. And so I asked her, I said, how has your relationship with God changed? And this is what she said. For several years now, I have felt called to serve. I have struggled tremendously with what that meant for a sinner like me. I am snarky. I have all the answers. I like to cuss. And I'm not really easy to love. I have been through a lot. I have had my share of hard knocks, all of which have made me the person that I am today. Trying to understand why God wants to use me, of all people, was hard to comprehend. Pastor Amy shared the book Accidental Saints, Finding God in All the Wrong People, and I started to see how God might use me. I started to see how our brokenness is what actually connects us to one another. I took the lay servant class and I led a porch group with my husband, but I felt like it wasn't quite what I was called to do. Then I heard about Stephen Ministry and I felt the gentle nudge of the Holy Spirit. The training for this ministry has really been life-changing for me. Walking this path with amazing people has impacted my relationships with my students, my family, and my relationship with God. I've learned how to be a better listener, caregiver, and how to walk next to someone and not drag them down the path that I know is right. My relationship with God has been impacted. Getting to be the hands and feet of God, getting to be the listening ear, getting to pray with and for the lost, and walk through the valley of the shadow of death next to the broken sinner like me has helped me to see why God loves even the most broken. Sometimes we have to suffer and become broken in order to have enough cracks to let God's light shine through. Sometimes the more broken we are, the brighter we shine. And I love that because the changes that brought that brokenness are what compels others to see Jesus in Mindy and in all of you. The cracked pot that we talked about a month or so ago is when the light shines through and what God uses to reach others. If we don't share the good news of Jesus Christ, then who will? Who are you called to be the light to? Who are you called to tell about the changes that you've experienced through Jesus? That's the secret. We don't just change for ourselves, we change so that we can be used by God to reach out to others. So, who is on your heart? Who is around you that doesn't know? Who can you share the life-changing news of Jesus with today? Who needs to know the peace that only can be found in Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for gathering us into your presence, and we ask for you to show us someone around us who needs to know you more. Give us courage, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to have communion, so if you're serving, please come forward. As we go into communion, we remember that this meal was the beginning of a change. A change because Jesus Christ would give up his life for us. And he knew that, and he might have even been a little afraid of that, but he still did it out of love. And before he would sacrifice himself, Jesus Christ took bread, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then when the supper was over, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out freely for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink from this, all of you. And when you do, remember me." Let us pray. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice and on these your children. As they come forward and are nourished by the bread and the juice, may they be filled up, empowered, made more like you. In your name we pray. Amen. This is an open table. It is open to you wherever you find yourself. Jesus will meet you here. So come as you feel led, and you can kneel at the altar after for time with God.
Open eyes to see.
reaching out to find you. With open eyes to see, we cannot live without your love. We cannot live without your love. Oh God, I cannot live without your love. Open eyes to see, I cannot live without your love, cannot live without your love, cannot live without your love. Father, I need. Father, I need every breath I breathe. Oh, I need you every moment of my day. Yes, Lord, I need you. We need you. Father, we need you more and more. We need you.
God has called us here together to worship, and even though we had a couple of hiccups there, I appreciate your continual push to dig deeper and to lean into God. So this morning, I'm going to invite you to say our benediction with me. It's just going to be the Lord's Prayer. Would you join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. May God bless you.